person you would go to if you had a problem? Who is the person who sacrifices himself or herself for the good of the team? Who is the person who prioritizes others rather than himself or herself? Think of your own team right now. Think of previous teams you've been on. Who is that person? It doesn't have to be an athletic team. It could be a classmate. It could be someone in a music class. It could be anyone. But in the broadest sense, who is the best teammate that you have had? Now, think about your family. What family member would you go to with a problem or with an issue? Who would you want to discuss your innermost thoughts with in your family? Is there someone in your family to do that? So now you've thought about a family member and a teammate who you would confide in and trust and depend upon. The gentleman who is speaking today to us is John Trautwine. And John Trautwine is the best teammate that I've ever coached. John was there for his teammates and continues to be there for his teammates. He was a college baseball pitcher at Northwestern University. He was a very good college baseball pitcher. He went on to professional baseball, and he was not drafted, but he signed an independent league contract, which is the lowest level of baseball. And 7 years later, because of his attitude, and because of being a great teammate and success on the mound, he was pitching for the Boston Red Sox. After his career in baseball, he went on to a business career and quickly rose to the presidency of his company. So he was very successful in business as well. He also started a family and had four children, all of whom were wonderful kids. And it was Mr. and Mrs. America type of family. A perfect family. If you would ask any of John's teammates or his business associates about John Trautwine, they would not talk about his business accomplishments. They would not talk about his achievements in baseball. They would talk about his being a life teammate with them and the role that he has played in so many people's lives because of the person he is. He is their go-to guy. Life was perfect for John Trautwine until tragedy struck their family. And John is here to talk with you today about his life and the tragedy that he experienced and his family experienced, and how he is here to help us today to make sure that that never happens to any of us. Please welcome John Trautwine.
Thank you, Ron. I need to remember to be nicer to him. So It's been a fun day so far. I've been on camp. I got here last night in the tornado, and I've been here all day and will be here all night as well. But this is a special one. This is a special opportunity for me to get to talk with you guys, to talk with the student athletes here at Wake. And my goal today is to get you guys to walk out of here with perhaps just a slightly different mindset and maybe look in the mirror at yourself slightly differently. And the way you think about the relationships in your life, the way you think about the teammates in your life and those people in your life that you want to be there for. And my goal today is to motivate you. My goal today is to inspire you, because you guys are in a situation right now which is very special. It's also very hard. So my goal really over the next 35, 45 minutes is to get you to think. And if I can do that, I'll be successful. I'm going to start by introducing my family. My wife, Susie, Will, Tommy, Michael, and Helen, four kids. We live in Johns Creek, Georgia, which is a suburb of Atlanta. I grew up in the Chicago area, and my wife grew up in the Philadelphia area, so we moved down south about 21 years ago. I am now, as Ron said, I run a small IT services company. We have a happy home. I was, as Ron said, I was fortunate enough to get to play college sports like you guys are doing, and then spent 7 years in the minor leagues, 6 years in the minor leagues, and 1 year in the big leagues with the Red Sox. If you guys Google me, you'll be very disappointed. I wasn't that good. I looked good, but I wasn't that good. Susie, the real athlete in the family, was a two-sport athlete at the University of Virginia. She played field hockey and lacrosse. So both Susie and I were on teams for a very long time. Teams like you guys are on today, where everybody in the dugout and everybody in the sidelines and everybody in the room had very similar challenges, very similar obstacles, had to deal with crazy psycho coaches and all that fun stuff that you guys go through today. And so we had a very teammate approach to our parenting, and we were team Troutwine, and you love your brothers and sisters and your teammates, and you love your teammates on and off the field, and good teams win, and great teams love each other, and none of us is as good as all of us, and every cliche that you guys hear on a regular basis, we incorporated that into our parenting, and we had fun doing it. A very, very loving home. My wife is nuts about me. I'm nuts about her. And I'm telling you this because this family, the Troutwines of Johns Creek, Georgia, had a good thing going. And if you ask our neighbors, they would tell you that we were living the dream. And the dream ended, came to a crashing halt 7.5 years ago when our oldest child, our son Will, took his life. He was a freshman in high school at Northview High School in North Atlanta suburbs. Big, strong, handsome, healthy, successful in all walks of life, had good grades. He was a good athlete. He was an extremely good musician. He was in a band. He wrote songs. Very accomplished guitarist. He played the drums. He taught himself how to play the piano. This guy had it all. He was the consultant of his friends, and he had an army of them. And they loved him, and he loved them, and it was just an absolute joy to see him interact with his pals. We were so shocked at his death that I thought someone had come into our home and murdered him. I had no idea. Hands-on, loving dad, hands-on, loving mom. We had no idea that Will was struggling in any way, shape, or form. His friends, he played lacrosse. They lifted on Thursday night, and he killed himself Friday morning. They were with him. His best friends were with him. He had so many friends. In fact, on the day that he died, everybody was coming to our house to be with us. And about 12 different kids came up to me and said, "Hey, Mr. Troutwine, I'm Jim, I'm John, I'm Siobhan, I'm whatever. I'm Will's best friend. I was Will's best friend." Guys I didn't even know were coming up to me saying, "I was Will's best friend." That's the kind of kid he was. Nobody had any clue that that young man was struggling in any way, shape, or form. The night before he died, we went and we had pizza at Arizona's Pizza in Johns Creek. And I said, "Will, we're going to have pizza tonight. It's a Thursday night." He said, "Oh, Dad, I have a geology test tomorrow. Can you test me?" I said, "Sure." So he brought with him to the restaurant note cards, about 25 of them. Guys, he knew the answer to every single question for a test that was going to be at 10 o'clock in the morning. He hung himself in his room at 3 in the morning. He said goodnight to me that night. Guys, if you would have told me that my son was struggling in any way, shape, or form, I would have told you were crazy. That's how clueless I was. And of course, course, that's how devastated I was. And instantly, out of the woodwork, people started coming to me. The day of his death, the weekend of his death, I was getting business cards, I was getting books, I was getting phone numbers and contacts of mental health specialists and counselors and therapists and suicidologists and all of these people right in my neighborhood in Johns Creek, Georgia, that I didn't even know existed, because suicide doesn't happen to the Troutwine family. That's not a word in my vocabulary. It was never mentioned. If somebody would have told me that my son had depression, I would have been pissed off. I would have gotten right in their face and said, hold on. We're the Troutwines. We're fine. Will's a stud. He's got it going. Don't you tell me that. I know my son. Couldn't have been more wrong. And what was really unbelievable to me is I started to hear comments from friends about their neighbors, about their college roommates, about their parents, about their kid, whatever it might be. They all had a story of depression, of mental illness, and even suicide. And that 1 in 6 of you all suffer from some form of depression or other diagnosable mental illness. 1 in 6 of you. So how many of you know somebody with depression? Every single one of you needs to raise your hand. Because every single one of you knows a lot of people that have depression. I know, and I knew a lot of people that suffered from depression, and I had no idea. I had no idea that depression was an illness. It was a physical deformity of the brain that treatment and medication and therapy heals. It's treatable, it's curable, it's common, and it's okay. But I didn't know it. And because I didn't know it, my son died. I thought he was great. I thought he was perfect. I thought we just had it all going. And it kills me to even think about this. I was always telling him, isn't this great, Will? Isn't this awesome? Look at these fields. Look at these tournaments you get to play in. Man, you have a cross tournament in Charlotte. You're going to go overnight with your teammates for 3 days. My first overnight trip when I was a freshman in college. You're a freshman in high school. You've been on 5 of them. I didn't get to do any of this cool stuff that you're doing. Isn't this great, Will? Isn't this great? I don't think it is great. He never said that to me because my personality was too strong. I didn't give him a chance because he knew I would just talk him out of it. And I had no idea that every 13 minutes somebody in America takes their life and every 2 hours is a teenager. Or young adult. I had no idea that 1 in 10 college students already have a plan of how they're going to take their life. Because of that, Will's gone. You all know people who are struggling. Just be aware of that one. Because depression is treatable, it's common, often curable, and it's okay. And I want you guys to understand it's okay to not be okay. And I never once said that to Will. And I regret that. And after he died, I started to spend a lot of time with his friends. And in my research and trying to figure out how somebody living in my loving, happy home would lose the will to live, I started to really look deep into the day in the life of a kid like Will. And as I started to talk to his friends and learn more about really what you guys go through all day long in the course of your life, whether you're in middle school, high school, or here at Wake. And one thing I noticed that I would have never expected to say is right there. Probably the most important slide I'm going to show you today. You guys have a heart. It is hard. You all have it harder than I did, than your coaches did, than your athletic director did, than your counselors did, than your teachers and your ministers, and your scout leaders, your youth leaders, every single trusted adult in your life did not have it as hard as you do growing up right now in this world. And you don't hear that very often, do you? I certainly never said that to Will. I was kept saying, isn't this great? Isn't this wonderful? Isn't this awesome? I didn't have all of this stuff. And when I talk to parents, sometimes I get the look, particularly from dad. Get this look. Okay, you're telling me that my son, who is on scholarship here at Wake Forest and drives a nice car, has it harder than I did when I was his age? I couldn't didn't have money for a car until I was graduated from college, et cetera, et cetera. You're telling me my son has that harder than me. And I was like, keep it coming. Yeah, and I walked uphill in the snow with no shoes, both ways, every day, all these fun things, right? I'm like, come on, Dad, keep it coming. What else you got? What else you got? Tell me how hard it was for you. And then when he's done, I'll say this. Did you have this? And they say, no. Did you have this when you were in elementary school, when you were in middle school, when you were in high school, or when you were in college? And they'll say, no. And I'll say, I win. What comes with this is unlike anything we had to deal with, we adults had to deal with when we were your age. I am impressed with how you guys have had to navigate through this 24/7 crazy world on a daily basis. I am impressed with how you guys find a way to navigate through this. It really is hard. And I just wish once I would have said to Will, wow, this is hard, isn't it, man? I didn't realize it was this hard. Because I kept saying, isn't this awesome and isn't this great? 5 days before he died, we were coming back from a practice, and I stopped the car. 5 days. And I said, oh, Will, let's switch. He said, what? I'm going to be you. He said, what? Oh, look at this, Will. And he had no idea what I was saying. And I was like, this is so great. I'm so excited for you. You've got so much ahead of you. This is how clueless I was, guys. I was Mr. Motivational. I was inspirational. This is going to be fun. I could see it. He was going to someday sit in a class like you and have teammates like you. And I was so excited for him. And all he wanted to do was say to me, I'm not doing okay. But he knew I wouldn't accept that. He knew I would try to talk him out of it because I was uneducated and unaware of the challenges that he had and uneducated and unaware of the fact that depression is in our lives. And while I was saying, isn't this awesome, he was getting bombarded by a 24/7 negative world. You guys have already gone through that upper left-hand corner, the challenges of getting into school and what school are you going to get into. Well, I'm telling you right now, when you guys are out of school, you're going to come to guys like me, and you're going to interview for a job with a guy like me. And I'm not going to say this. So what did you get in AP Lit when you were a junior in high school? Oh, you got a B? Oh, that's too bad. That's going to hurt you. I'm not going to ask you your grade point average at Wake. I sure will take a look at the fact you were on the team. I'm sure I'm going to look at the fact that you went to college and you were a college athlete. Trust me, I will be looking at that. I won't be looking at the Wake Forest degree, though. Sorry. I'll be looking at you. How did you answer the question? How did you look me in the eye? How did you shake my hand? What was your presence like when I gave you a really ridiculous question that made no sense? How did you answer that? When I made you feel uncomfortable, how did you handle that? When I talked to your references, what do your friends say about you? What do your teammates say about you? What's your sense of urgency like? You just come in a little bit early to make sure we hit that deadline. You stay a little bit late. When something goes wrong, you take ownership of it and fix it. The Wake Forest degree doesn't tell me that. You guys tell me that. And when I talk to high school, it says it's not the school, it's you. So now I'm talking to you guys. It's still you. It's still you. The beauty of this, what you guys have, and it's an advantage. You have this team. You have this experience of being on a team and the importance of being on the team. And whatever cliche you want to say, right? You can't whistle a symphony. You can't. It takes a whole orchestra to play it. One person isn't going to win the soccer match. This is not going to happen. You guys are on a team. Rejoice in that. Be thinking about that. Be thinking about that answer. What do you like best about yourself? I'm hoping somewhere in that answer is how good of a teammate you are and how well you work together with others, because that's going to be a key to your success. And you guys get this because you're so entrenched in a team on a daily basis. You have an advantage. And you have a chance to lead this. And you guys understand the athletic pressure of it. I pitched in the big leagues. Wasn't very good, but I got there. I don't make my high school baseball team today. Because when I was 11, I wouldn't have made the travel team. Because I was a dork when I was 11. But back in 1974, the world allowed me to grow, and society had patience, and I could gain 100 pounds and grow 6 inches and get a scholarship to Northwestern. After my junior year in high school where I didn't even play. Now, why does that happen today? Dreams are ending at a very early age for the kids today. Do you guys understand that? We were talking about one sports and two sports. I got to play three sports. I'll tell you what, I don't make the big leagues without playing high school basketball. No way. What that taught me playing high school basketball helped me so much in baseball, it was unbelievable. You guys don't get that today. You have to dedicate yourself pretty early. It's just kind of a bummer because I think there's a satisfaction of being able to do multiple things like that. But the world has changed and we get it. Talking about social, right? I've already shown to this. When Debbie Feeker dumped me, which, by the way, she regrets. And I'm not bitter about it at all. But nobody tweeted it. Wasn't on Facebook. My relationship status didn't change. There wasn't an Instagram post. There wasn't on Snapchat. There was no story about it. When Will's girlfriend broke up with him 6 weeks before he died, he found out about it from a friend who saw it on Facebook. Dude, she dumped you.
What?
Yeah, it's on Facebook.
Yeah, oh, there's a picture of him of her with Jim.
Not only did he find out that his girlfriend dumped, but he also saw a picture of her new boyfriend, who was one of his old friends. I didn't have to deal with that kind of stuff. We didn't have to deal with that kind of stuff. You guys all know that if you make a mistake today, there's a decent chance that everybody you have ever met in your life will know about it by dinner. Because it's social media. Obviously, if you do well, they'll know about it too, so that's kind of nice. But I'll tell you what, man, the pressures that come with that. People said, what was the difference between the minor leagues and the major leagues? Well, the minor leagues, if I gave up a home run, the 114 people in the stands knew that I sucked. Right? In the big leagues, if I gave up a home run, it was ESPN playing the game, and 33,000 people were yelling, I suck, in unison. And it was in every single newspaper across the country. But I was 25 years old. You guys are in the big leagues now when it comes to mass communication and exposure, and it's very difficult. You guys are going to start your job hunting. 30-40% of unemployment are millennials. You're saddled with college debt, unlike any generation before. It's not going to be easy. It's going to be hard. But who best understands that? Who best understands what you guys are all going through? Me? Coach? Or your teammate? Pretty obvious answer. I was at a golf outing for a retirement community in Sanibel, Florida last week, speaking to my father and his 40, 75, to 85-year-old friends. I said, who understands what goes on in the life of a 75-year-old retiree down in Fort Myers? Your son? I'm thinking he's living the dream. He's down in Florida, doesn't have to work. He's playing golf 3 days a week. I'm thinking he's living the dream. He has trouble getting up every morning. He has trouble remembering where things are. Who best understands my father? Me or the other 15 guys at his table that are 75 years old going through those same things? Very logical, very obvious answer. Your teammates get you guys. Understand that. So I'm thinking about this and I'm learning all about this. And I'm thinking, well, how do I do this? How do I get, I want to get you guys to talk. Will never told anybody. He never said a thing to anybody that he was hurting or that he was struggling. And as a result, nobody knew. And an illness that doesn't get treated can lead to a tragedy. And he had depression. He had what's called functional depression, where you can hide it and you can mask it. And nobody knew he was struggling. So I'm trying to think, well, how do I get them to talk? How do I get them to talk to each other? And at Will's funeral, I stood up here and gave the eulogy. The whole left-hand side of the church, they were in their lacrosse uniforms. And I was talking to them how Will almost frustrated me sometimes because he could have been really good, but he didn't really care to be really good. And from a relatively competitive guy, that kind of bugged me a little bit. Come on, you should be the one scoring that goal. He was just happy to be there. He just loved being on that team. And he rejoiced in the success of his teammates. And I'm preaching this almost to his teammates. And then I started noticing. There's Paul Tickey. There's Jimmy Bartels. There's Mark Savard. Mark Savard was the other guard on my 7th grade basketball team 30 years ago in Barrington, Illinois. Hadn't spoken to him, hadn't seen him in 30 years. He had traveled from upstate Wisconsin to Atlanta to be there for me 3 days after he heard my son die. There's Jimmy Bartels. He was the first baseman on the Zank Construction Cardinals Little League team. There's Grady. There's Scooch. There's Fife. There's Dick. And I started to see all of these old friends of mine. And my wife noticed the same thing. All of the groomsmen in my wedding were there. Guys from my freshman football team. Guys from my high school baseball team, basketball team. Guys from my college team. We're going to pause this presentation for 1 minute. I want you to look in the upper right-hand corner. See that guy number four? That's your athletic director. He was there. And I started to realize that these guys that were there were really my life friends. These were the guys that I learned about my first with. I experienced life together. We were in the trenches together. We had to deal with the crazy psycho coaches. But we did it together. And we were there for each other. But when I got engaged, I called them and we talked about it. When my wife became pregnant, we called them, we talked about it. We had our first baby, we called them. We shared all of these moments and they were there for me. And it hit me that the greatest friends I ever had, my life friends, my life teammates, I met when I was your age, when I was Will's age. And I went, oh, had Will just known this, that maybe that he'd already met his groomsmen. You girls have met some, if not all, of your bridesmaids. They're probably in this room. Your hubby could be in this room, too. Just saying. Stranger things. So let's find a way to get kids to recognize the power that they have to deliver hope to each other. Because it is your teammates that truly understand what you're going through. And it was my teammates, it was my old friends that came from all over the country now to be there for me and just pick me up. And they helped me. And they were there for me. And they listened because I was hurting. And I was hurting bad. But they listened. And together we talked about what can we do. And they understood this concept of let's find a way to get these kids to reach out to each other and talk about it. Because you guys, it is hard what you're dealing with. And the issues that are going on here are similar to the issues that are going on there and similar to the issues over here. So who best understands what you're going through? It is you guys. Who's easier to talk to? Is it your teammates or is it your coach? Pretty obvious answers there. So that's what we said. I'm going to find the way, and this foundation that we're going to form to do something positive is going to do just that. Teach these kids to recognize that true love and true hope is found right there on the sidelines and right there in the classroom with their peers. And if we can do that, we can improve those relationships and say, hey, I know you're struggling because life is hard. Life, like football, is unfair and it's hard, but I'm here. And you'll call me, right, man? And if we can get you guys to do this, I can also get you to say, hey, and that's really this concept of increasing the will to live by increasing the relationships in your lives. And it starts with those guys sitting next to you. And so this concept of a teammate is such an easy sell. And we started to do this. I was just up in Ashland, Massachusetts, and they started a club, Will to Live. The same thing. It is a high school club. There's a club, Will to Live, at the University of Georgia now. There's one at Georgia Tech. There's one in Alabama. And it's a place to go. They raise money for other foundations, that they do it together, and it's a place to go because life can be tough, and they get it. And it's fun to see this happening, because if I can get you guys to talk to each other, I can get you guys to listen to each other. And this is so important right now. When you hear or see a friend, you need to act. Will never spoke out. Will never told anybody he was thinking of killing himself. But if he did, what would they have done? Well, hopefully they would have done now. They would have acted. They would acknowledge, they would care, and they would tell. And this is a concept that is being delivered through schools all over America. And there's a company that we partner with, a foundation partner with, called Screening for Mental Health, that we're bringing down here to this community to implement into the high schools and into the colleges as well. Acknowledge, I know you're serious, man. Whether you agree with it, whether you understand it, doesn't matter. I know you're serious. I just want you to know I'm here, and you care, and you show the love. You show them the good that they can't see. You show them the grass actually is green on their side. And then, T, you tell somebody. You tell that trusted adult. You tell your coaches. You tell your parents. You tell your ministers. You tell your teachers, your counselors. You tell those people in your lives that, hey, we have a problem. Because if you don't, if you have a friend who is in need and he never talks about it or she never talks about it and never gets treatment, it can lead to tragedy. I'm here to tell you that firsthand. That's what happened to Will. He never got a chance. I never got a chance to help him because I didn't know. So I spent this morning from 9:30 to 10:30 talking with, there was 400 educators. I said, well, you guys need to understand these kids have it hard. They have it harder than you did. Yes, you still have to do it. But just understand that it's hard and we get it. And if I can get you teachers and you coaches to understand that, showing them that this is hard. Yes, of course, they still have to do it. They still have to discipline. But showing them that you understand, I can get you guys to improve that relationship and improve their will to live. Because there is good. There's always good. I'm here to tell you, there is always good. We'll have some fun with this one. My third game in the league.
And 3-1 to come down with wire.
My first two games, I had done really well. This is my third game. I'm thinking I would have been right now. Mark McGuire is the batter.
Go with Weiss and Lynn coming together.
The announcer just said, oh my goodness. Man, I wish I was in Winston-Salem right now.
Number 11 for McGuire ties in with Ken Herbeck for the American League lead.
Pre-steroids. Can't even blame that. The ball went over the green monster. It went over the 50 feet of netting above the green monster. It went over the street on the other side of the green monster. It went over the bars on the other side of the street where everybody goes. Just talked about the moonshot that rookie pitcher just gave up. And it landed, debatable if it ever came down. If it landed, it landed somewhere on the Massachusetts Turnpike. You guys are looking at and listening to the guy who gave up the longest home run in the history of Fenway Park. Thank you.
I went too fast. All right.
So, that sucked. There was nothing good in that. It was the ESPN play of the game. They showed it 100 times. I had the jitters by the time I went to bed. My father's calling me, what the hell pitch was that you threw right there? You know, everybody's giving me a hard time. My own teammates were actually kind of laughing. Jesus. I don't think the ball came down. I'm serious. Those kind of whispers were going on in a locker room at Fenway Park. And I'm thinking, there's nothing good right now. I'm going to be in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, playing AAA by Monday. That's going through my head, and I'm just not happy. The next day, I had lunch with an old teammate of mine who played with Ron with me at Northwestern. He happened to be in town on business. I left him tickets for Fenway. And he said, he knows I'm upset. He knows I'm mad. And he's like, Trout, is it safe to say, let me just ask you one question. Is it safe to say that at some point in your life, you had a dream that you would strike somebody out in the big leagues? And I'm like, what? Because you heard me. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I guess. And he goes, John, that happened last night. And I was in the stands. I was at Fenway Park looking at my best friend who I used to play catch with when we were 5. I saw him get his first major league strikeout. And I was sitting there, I was crying, and my colleague's like, what's wrong with you? He goes, you don't understand, this is huge. Trout just got his first big league strikeout. You know what my answer to him was? I did? I had no idea. I had achieved a lifelong dream, but I was so focused on the negative, I was so focused on the mistake, I was so focused on the bad, that I missed the good. And yes, the home run was more monumental than a routine strikeout. But my point is, I was so obsessed with the negative that I missed something that was really positive in that day. And I went home and I saw the videos and I was like, wow, that actually was kind of cool. I wish I would have recognized that. That ball should be sitting on my mantle somewhere. The only ball I ever talked about was the one that landed on the Massachusetts Turnpike. Sometimes it takes a friend. I've already talked about these statistics. I'm challenging you guys to be that friend, to point out those little base hits, those little good blocks, those little good passes, the things you don't read about in the paper. Because that's the kind of stuff that makes teams. And all their coaches would agree with me. It's the little things, guys. It's the little things, gals, that make great teams. Sometimes you need a friend to show it to you. And you guys are going to be hitting with these statistics and these issues and these problems, and you're trying to, and you're going to think, you're going to start thinking negative of yourself. I hire millennials all the time. Millennials are used to instant satisfaction and instant gratification because of the internet, because of their cell phones. They have answers. They get things done right away. It's very impressive. But I hired a guy. He's 24 years old. He's doing a heck of a job. He's been with me 6 months. And he came into my office, and I thought he was going to cry. I said, Danny, what's wrong? And he said, well, I'm not getting promoted. And I'm like, dude, it was 3 years before I got my first promotion. That was 1990. It's a different world right now. And I had to kind of revamp my whole approach to managing a millennial because I didn't understand my audience. He was really upset. He was stressing out. He was not sleeping. He had anxiety. He thought he was failing. And he was doing great. So I was failing in communicating with him. When you guys do get that first job, it'll be 6 months into it, and they may have ignored you. Understand your audience. You may be working for an old guy like me. And if you understand that, and if we communicate that better, it works a little bit better. Rejoicing in life singles. That report card is a pretty good report card. I had fun with the teachers today. What's that? 3 A's, a B plus, and a C. My dad would have said, don't come home with a C. What I'm trying to get you guys is to realize that is a very good report card, and that is a very good student. And yeah, he has an issue with the C. But maybe we try a different approach. Maybe we start thinking, okay, well, what's good? What is happening that's good right now? And how can we apply what's happening in the classes that he's getting an A to the class that he's getting a C? Time to maybe a little bit talk about the positives first to try to understand and make sure we're incorporating the positives into everything we do. Time for coaches and teachers and to start thinking, let's start rejoicing in life's sacrifice bunts and life's singles. What do you think that coach is saying right now to that guy? I think it's something like, hey, man, I just want to let you know I love you. Right? I had over 200 coaches, 7 of them get Christmas cards. 7. Ron's one of them. He was tough on me. He was very tough on me, but you know what? When I did well, he had passion. He was like, you finally did it. You threw stripes. You didn't walk up and grab you. Way to go! And he'd be spitting all over me. Yeah, all right, brother. All right, thanks. And he'd get emotional and active. He was pumped because he believed in me. He was happy that I did well. And he saved some of that passion for a positive thing. And I challenge you coaches to do that, not to forget that. Because that's the kind of guy you run through the wall for. And when I did mess up, he got right in my face and he's spitting all over me and all that kind of stuff. But then he said to me, do you understand why? And that, to me, was what the coach was all about. I understood why. He made sure of it. And I think those are the kind of coaches, those are the kind of teachers that you go back and visit. Back in high school, when you guys were freshmen, you came home for Thanksgiving, you probably went and visited a coach or a teacher. That's the teacher that you teachers in the audience want to be. That's the coach that you coaches in the audience want to be, because these kids have it hard. And it is a crazy, negative, ridiculous world that we're living in right now. Be that coach that motivates and inspires. All right. On the left, I know the baseball team isn't in here. Those of you who are not familiar with baseball, as a pitcher, throwing the ball belt high right down the middle is not recommended. So, really, on the left, that's my pitch to Mark McGuire. It was me saying, hey, Merry Christmas, Mark, all the best. And he launched it. My pitching coach, Bill Fisher, great guy, wonderful man, does not get a Christmas card from me.
Trout one, don't throw the ball down the middle to McGuire. And he walked out.
Okay. Thank you, Coach. I'm inspired, I'm motivated, and that was actually quite brilliant.
On the right is that nasty strikeout pitch to Stan Javier. My teammate, Wes Garner, says, Trout, what was that pitch you struck out Javier on? I said, it was a sinker. He goes, dude, that was nasty. You need to throw that more often. That was the best sinker I've seen in years. Why the heck aren't you throwing that? You do that really well, John. Throw that pitch more often. I hope you guys get this point. We really do spend a lot of time learning from our mistakes. Yes, I learned not to throw the ball down the middle. But what my teammate taught me was, where should I throw it? And it was this concept of, you know, you're going to go through, you get jobs, and they're going to talk about mistakes, and mistakes are learning experiences, and you learn from your mistakes. Learn. Corrective action, root cause analysis, preventive maintenance, and continual measurements to ensure that mistake never happens again. I want you to take that farther. What is it that I do really well? Why did we win that game? Why was this game so good? What the heck did we do? I get to a point now, right? What did I have for breakfast? What is it that we did today that made it so magical? And how can I learn from that and incorporate it into the next game? Why does this customer love us? And this customer doesn't love us. Oh, well, we make a bunch of mistakes for these guys. No, we make mistakes for everybody. My worry with my business was we spend so much time fixing this mistake that we have to do. I get it. We took our eye off the ball and we stopped doing that special thing. We stopped dancing with them that we were doing before because we're so focused on the negative. And I just really challenge on you guys to understand, what is it that I do really well? How can I do it more often? What is it that I love to do, and how can I do that? What is it that I do really well? What do I love to do, and what's my major? That's a nice little triad right there. What do I love to do? What am I really good at? What industry do I want to go in? This Will Live Foundation has completely changed my life because of things like that. Do I look like a guy who's grieving over the suicide death of his son? There's a bounce in my step. I've got energy. I'm into this. Good at this. I'm a sales and marketing guy. I'm a relationships guy. I'm a people guy. What am I doing right now? All of that. So why in heck would I be sitting on my desk looking at a spreadsheet? I might be good at that, analyzing a business report, but I don't love to do it. So why don't I hire somebody who loves to analyze spreadsheets? There are people like that out there. Maybe some of you guys are that. I'm not. So what did I do? I just completely changed my approach to my job. And I started getting out there. And the following year, I visited customers, you know, four times as much as the year before. And I had fun because I was doing something that was good. I was building relationships. I was motivating. I was inspiring. And it didn't matter if it was a will to live chat or talk to a team or a visit to a customer or chat with my employees and my teams and trying to get these guys to improve on a daily basis. You guys all do so many things well. Don't ignore that. Don't forget that when you're correcting these mistakes. And I challenge you coaches to understand that. What really happened well today? Let's remember that. Let's write that one down. Because that is the kind of stuff that we often forget. Don't let that home run you give up miss the strikeout. It'll bring a whole new world of positive passion into your life. We're getting towards the end here. A trusted adult. Remember I talked about acknowledge, care, and tell. The trusted adult is that person that you talk to. You acknowledge your friends have a problem, you acknowledge, you show them the love, the life teammate approach, you care, and then you go see a trusted adult and say, hey, we have a problem.
trusted adults are your coaches, they are your counselors, they are your parents, they could be your ministers, they could be your aunts and uncles and family adults in your lives. When I speak to the adults, and I want you guys to hear this, because here's why. We're clueless. We don't know. There is no class for parenting. We don't know, guys. So have some patience with us, because all we want is for you guys to be okay. And your parents love you, and they want you to be okay. But they can never really understand what goes on in your world here, because it's unlike the world that they grew up in. And I fear that my son never said that. He knew that I loved him, and we had a great relationship, but he never said to his buddies, yeah, my dad really gets me. Because I kept saying, isn't this great? Isn't this wonderful? Isn't this cool? Isn't this great? And I was there. And I was pushing him away by doing that, because he didn't feel that. And when his girlfriend broke up with him 6 weeks before, I was there. And I wiped a tear out of his eye. And I hugged him. And I said, oh, Will, you're going to be okay. And I tell you the story about Debbie Kaker, how she dumped me and she regrets it now. And look at your mom, she's hot. You're going to be fine. And I made him laugh. And I was like, I was a good dad. I was making him laugh. I was there. And I was like, yeah, I got this thing. I got this thing. I'm not fine, Dad. I want to die. He didn't say that. And it bothers me today that I didn't have that sort of, that he didn't think that way about me. But his younger brother, Tommy, who's now a sophomore at Georgia, he had a girlfriend issue 2 years later. And I said, oh, Tommy, that sucks. What are you going to do? He said, I don't know. Is he a friend you can talk to? I'm 50. I don't know anything about young love. And it was very hard for me because Tommy was clearly not okay. And my job as a parent is to make them be okay. I can't stand to see my kids not okay. Just like your parents can't stand to see you not okay. But what I didn't realize is that maybe it is okay to not be okay. Because I started to think in my life, I used to think about my dad. And every time I had a bad game, my dad would say, did I ever tell you about the time I gave up 9 straight walks and then gave up the Grand Slam and got good and all this? He always had something worse. And I'd be like, Dad, can I just be miserable for 5 minutes, please? He'd say, no, I want you to be okay. Tommy, I walked away from Tommy with every ounce of energy I had to not go back in there and tell him about Debbie Fieger and how she broke up with me and how she regrets it and how I got married and like your mom's hot and everything's going to be great. I really wanted to do that. And I didn't. And I just said, okay, Tommy, I'm sorry, Matt. That's a bummer, man. Hang in there. I didn't have any answer. And the next day, I get a text from Tommy. Dad, Jenna and I had a great chat today. We're all cool. Thank you so much for the talk last night. We have no idea, guys. I said, that sucks, and I don't know. Greatest piece of parenting in my career. Your parents are just like me. It's so important for you guys to understand this. Help us. Help us in that communication. If I can increase the relationships between you and your parents, if I can increase the relationships between you and your friends, I'm going to increase your will to live. And that's really what my goal is through all of this. And I'm not asking you guys to study harder. I'm not asking you guys to spend money. I'm not asking you guys to do more suicide sprints or anything like that. I'm just asking you guys to be there for your friends and acknowledge that you have life teammates in your life and that it's hard. Together, let's get those adults in your life to understand that it is hard. I just took a tour of the Wake Forest baseball facility today. So what year is it? 35 years ago? Day in life of a college baseball player when I was at Northwestern versus day in life of a college baseball player right here. Can't compare it at all. It is a completely different game. Completely different day in the life. And I think that's just so important for us to understand. So help those adults in your life understand. And you guys need to help each other understand that it is okay
to not be okay. Let's talk about it. Because life, like soccer, like football, like track and field and cross country, in fact, a lot like track and field and cross country for me, is hard. And together, it becomes easier. None of us is as strong as all of us. So give yourself that. Be patient with yourself. That says 1090. It doesn't say 199. When my friend told me that 10% is what happens to you, 90% what you do with it, I was like, okay, I'm going to be 90. I'm going to be Mr. 90. I'm going to make something good. I'm going to do this. They said, stop. You're doing 199. You got to give yourself that 10. Give yourself that 10. Give yourself that chance to grieve. Give yourself that 10. A chance to not be okay once you're on. Understand that you're not alone, and it's normal. And people with depression are normal. It's common. It's treatable. It's curable. And it's okay. And I think that's the message here. And you guys are on teams, and you can be the leaders of this. And you can be the leaders of this community. The importance of being there for your teammates, on and off the field. The greatest teammate activity I was ever exposed to was 35 years after my last game. Those teammates were there for me. And they carried me through. And it was inspirational to me and very motivational, but they allowed me and they encouraged me to have the 10. And then they helped me with the 90. And that's what I want you guys to do. I want you guys to truly understand that. You have life teammates that are struggling. You all have freshmen who just got here. You will have people in your lives that might not have life teammates. Be that kind of friend to give them a life teammate in yourself. You will feel better doing it. If I can get you all to not be afraid to show the love that you have for each other, I will have succeeded, because then I can get you guys to say, hey, I'm struggling. When was the last time you told your teammates and your pals that you love them? I have a little challenge right now. Every single person in this room right now to turn to the person next to you and say, I love you, man. All right, stop. Jeez. You kidding me? So, all I asked you guys to do was turn to the person next to you and say, I love you, man. I didn't ask you to start hugging each other and getting all excited and this huge wave of energy to come through this building, but that's what happened. Don't be afraid to drop a love you, man, on a teammate every once in a while. I have never been more serious than I am with that comment. This world could use a few more love you, man, and you guys all know it. Right? You watch the World Series, you watch the Super Bowl, you watch it every you know, we just love each other. Oh, we just team this chemistry, we just get along, we just love each other. It's one thing I love about college sports too. They even like something, where's the tennis team? Right? College tennis is so much more fun to watch than professional tennis. You know why? Right? Picture the Super Bowl. Who won the Super Bowl this year? The Eagles, my goodness. Do not tell my wife I just said that. So the Eagles win the Super Bowl, everybody goes nuts. The Astros win the World Series, everybody goes nuts. It's celebration and champagne. Is everybody going crazy? Who won Wimbledon? Federer? Who did? Yeah, Federer wins Wimbledon. You know what he did? He won the last point, and he's like, I got nobody to high five. There's nobody to hug. He had to run up into the stands to hug his mom. You guys, this concept of a team and sharing in this, just understand that. It's really great. And I miss it a little bit. I just lied. I miss it a lot. What you guys are doing right now, rejoice in that ability to share the win and the ability to share the loss and the struggle and get this thing together. It's so great, and you have that. And if I can get you guys to not be afraid to throw that line out once in a while, I can get
need you guys to talk about, hey, I'm struggling, and I'm there for you. Who are those life teammates, and do they know it? That's really the message I'm trying to give. And don't underestimate that power. And I'm very serious about this. When you do have that job interview, and you do have that grad school admission application, or whatever it might be, talk about how good of a teammate you are. Talk about how you live for it. Talk about how you enjoy it, because that's what guys like me are looking for. And you guys have a nice, your resume is very sharp. So understand that. You guys have a real opportunity. You guys, as active student athletes here at Wake Forest, are you kidding me? Your resume is strong. So don't give up when you don't get that first job, or 6 months and you're still looking for a job. Don't. Your resume is strong. Just remember that. That concept of being on a team is going to be a differentiator for you, and you have that. And that's a great thing. Any coaches and teachers, push that. Make them love this game. Right? They say play ball. They don't say stress ball, work ball, freak out ball. But that's what we tend to do because it's so hard. Remember, you're still playing a game. So play it together and have some fun doing it. So, I've asked you guys to talk. I've asked you guys to talk to each other. I've asked you guys to listen. This community, this university, and this community is committed to improving the mental health and the mental wellness in this community. I would take a picture of that. Because you all have friends that are struggling. Some of you may be struggling, but there are people 24/7 that want to help. Whether it's right here on campus from the counseling center or whether it's in the community. So just understand that. There's even counselors here today that are here for you guys if you do want to talk. And if it's not today, it's some other time. I just challenge you to do it. I miss my son. I miss him a lot. Never gave me a shot. Because I think you guys get it. I think you get what I'm trying to say here. I just want you to really think it through. And you haven't seen the last of me, and you haven't seen the last of this. This isn't a one and done kind of thing. We're trying to set up something that really improves the mental wellness on this campus and in this community. That's the goal. And I really appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak to you guys. I hope you guys have had some fun with it. I hope you're motivated a bit just to be able to talk to your friends and drop a love you man on your buddies once in a while and be there for them, because life's like hoops is hard. So I thank you guys, and I love you all, and I wish you all the very, very best. So thank you for that. Thank you.